ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today's talk is more or less of a reminder. It's nothing scientific. There's no rocket science involved, but it is a hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام that, as usual, would draw us closer to Allah the Almighty. And every hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام has a certain fragrance to it, a certain taste. And each word counts because he does not utter these words out of his own whims or desires. He utters them as a revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal. The hadith was reported in Musnad al-Imam Ahmad, Sunan Abi Dawood, and An-Nisa'i. Mu'adh ibn Jabal, may Allah be pleased with him, said that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam took his hand once and said, O Mu'adh, by Allah, I love you. By Allah, I love you. He repeated it twice. And then the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, I advise you, O Mu'adh, do not forget at the end of every prayer to say, Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. O Allah, help me to remember you, give thanks to you, and worship you in the best way. The hadith, everyone knows it. And I would not be exaggerating if I say that everyone says this at the end of his salah. However, let's remind ourselves of some of the benefits in this hadith so that it would emphasize to us that we should say it and that we should learn from the hadiths of the Prophet ﷺ. First of all, the Prophet swore by saying, Wallahi inni la uhibbuk. And we know that he is the honest, the truth worthy, the one who does not lie. So why does he swear? First of all, to indicate to us that swearing is permissible. It is permissible for you to swear whenever you want to do so. Yet Allah Azza wa Jal instructs us not to overdo it by saying, and protect your oaths. That is, do not swear much. However, if you need to swear, you can swear. The Prophet so often used to say, وَالَّذِي نَفْسِي بِيَدِهِ, I swear by whom my soul is in his hand. So the Prophet used to do it. So if you do it for a reason, for a purpose, this is halal. However, do not exaggerate. Do not overdo it on every single thing. And do not teach your children. Whenever you ask them something, say Wallahi. This is one of the biggest mistakes. Don't force them to lie. And this is not our topic. As I said, this hadith requires lectures. But this is the tip of an iceberg that we should, inshallah, try our level best to benefit from it. The second benefit is in his statement, Inni uhibbuk, I love you. And usually when we teach students English as a second language, we tell them, do not tell someone else you love him. They will think you as a gay. They'll take you as a homosexual. So you say, I like this man, if you're a man. But if it's a woman, that is your wife, of course. You say, I love this woman. And this would be a miracle. But miracles happen. So in Arabic, loving is a cordial feeling. It is something that is natural. It doesn't have to do with desires and all what these non-Muslims think of. And the Prophet ﷺ was portraying a prophetic etiquette, an Islamic feature, which is spreading the love among the masses. The Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, if someone loves his brother, he should notify him. If you love someone, you should notify him. And inshallah, I wouldn't be lying, but I love you all for the sake of Allah, though I don't know you. And this might be a lie, but for the sake of argument, we all love Muslims. So we love them for the sake of Allah. So I'm notifying you now. And the Prophet said, alayhi salatu wasalam, and the hadith was narrated by Anas ibn Malik, a man was with the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and walked by a third man. So the man said to the Prophet, "O Prophet of Allah, by Allah, I love this man." So the Prophet said, "Did you notify him? Did you tell him?" He said, "No." The Prophet said, "Go and tell him." So the man rushed to that brother of his and said, "By Allah, I love you for the sake of Allah." And the man replied, "May Allah love you as you have loved me." أحبك الله الذي أحببتني فيه. This etiquette has diminished, has disappeared in our material world. Because I love you, depending on your bank account, on the car that you ride, on the dirty jokes that you make me laugh when you tell them to me. I love you because you have wasita. You know what wasita is? I don't know if they're going to put it in Webster Dictionary nowadays, because even global is coming to the UK and to the US. Wasita. Vitamin wow, we call it. So I love him because he makes things easy with the government, with the jawazat, with the passports, with the Saudi Airlines booking, etc. But this is not what Islam preaches. The Prophet ﷺ described Islam as being knots. You know, a knot, a rope, when you tie it into a knot. So a number of knots make the rope really strong and tough. The Prophet said ﷺ, the toughest and strongest knots of Iman is to have allegiance for the sake of Allah and to have enmity for the sake of Allah, to love for the sake of Allah and to hate for the sake of Allah. So this is something that we have to spread. And the Prophet told us, Hassan, that you will not be able to enter paradise until you spread peace, until you love one another. As in the hadith. And should I tell you how to love one another? Spread as-salam baynakum. So whenever you see someone walking in the streets, don't look from the top of his head to his toes and back again, measuring him out, weighing him out. No, regardless of his race, regardless of his color, regardless of his nationality, he's a Muslim, immediately say as-salamu alaykum. You gain the highest hand, the upper hand, and you gain the highest reward of all. Now, Mu'adh, was he the only one that the Prophet used to love alayhi salatu wasalam among his companions? No. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was filled with emotions, positive emotions, and he would not hide it and conceal it like we men do. Men, generally speaking, have hearts of stone. They never express their gratitude, especially to their spouses, especially to their children. It would be difficult for me to go and hug one of my children, or to kiss them, or to cuddle them. This is not us. Maybe every blue moon, yes. The Prophet wasn't like that, alayhi salatu wasalam, at all. He was full of emotions, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and he was not hesitant to express these emotions. So he would go out of his way to express his love to Mu'adh. He would go out of his way to express his love to the whole tribe of Al-Ansar, who are made of different tribes, Aus, Khazraj, etc. He saw children and families coming back from a wedding once from the Ansar. And he addressed them by saying, "Wallahi, you are among the most beloved people to my heart." He would not conceal this. He would not hide it, alayhi salatu wasalam. He used to declare that Al-Hasan and Al-Husayn are among the loved ones to my heart. He used to say, Zayd ibn Haritha and his son Usama are the most beloved to my heart. And when Amr ibn al-As asked him, "Who among the people most that you love?" He said, "Aisha." He said, no, I meant among the men. He said, "Abu Bakr." Amr said, "Then who?" He said, "Umar." Amr was expecting that the Prophet say, "You." Because he embraced Islam recently on the 8th year of Hijrah. And because of the Prophet's well reception to him whenever he came in, he thought that he had this level of love in the Prophet's heart. So he wanted to hear it. And the Prophet kept on giving names of his companions. He did not mention his name, which meant that he met everyone with a smiling face and with a good reception to the extent that everyone who had met him صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم would think that he is the most favored and close to his heart. Now Mu'adh ibn Jabal, when we hear this hadith, which is authentic, but of course, one is shocked. يعني, what's so special about Mu'adh ibn Jabal for the Prophet to hold his hand and to repeat twice swearing, I love you, I love you. Now, just a small footnote. Inshallah, you brothers are intellectually adult and يعني, smart. I don't want, today's Thursday night, I don't want anyone to go down to the malls after the lecture and meets this beautiful woman and says, I love you for the sake of Allah. And says, the Sheikh told us to convey the message, so I'm notifying. No, this is for the same gender. Men says this to the men, and women say it to women. Otherwise, it would not be Islamic. It would be a different religion, probably. So what is so special about Mu'adh ibn Jabal? May Allah be pleased with him. Everything is special. It is sufficient, and the time does not allow us. It is sufficient to know that Mu'adh, may Allah be pleased with him, was among the first to accept Islam from the Ansar. He came with the convoy on the second Aqaba, Al-Aqaba al-Thaniya, and he was 16 years of age, or 18 years of age. And at this early age, to travel all the way to danger zone, and to be in enemy territory, and to have a relationship with someone who is considered to be enemy of the state number one, and to tell him to come, this is dangerous. But he had no fear because he was a Muslim. He's doing it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal. So he was among so many who embraced Islam. What's the big deal? No, he wasn't. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam indicated in many hadiths his scientific ability, his scholarly traits and characteristics. He was among the handful at the time, at the life of the Prophet ﷺ, who was allowed to give fatwa. Imagine the Prophet is here and you come and call me and ask Huda, Shaykh, what's the ruling on the... You crazy? The Prophet is here, alayhi salatu wasalam. Yet he was among the very few who were permitted to give fatwa. Not only that, the Prophet instructed the whole ummah to learn the Quran from four. Ubay ibn Ka'ab, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Salim Mawla bi Hudhayfa, and Ibn Ummi Abd. Who's Ibn Ummi Abd? Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. These four. So he was one of the highest ranking in knowledge of the Quran. The Prophet told us that on the Day of Judgment, he will come ahead of all scholars a throw of a stone. So he'd be ahead of them. And in a long hadith where he, alayhi salatu wasalam, specified to us, described to us the characteristics of the companions, Abu Bakr is so-and-so, Umar is so-and-so, Uthman is so-and-so. When he came to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, he said, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the most knowledgeable of them all in halal and haram. Now, this is something out of the ordinary. Not only that, the Prophet did not send to Yemen, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a nomad to teach them. He chose for them a judge, a teacher, and a ruler who was knowledgeable. And that is why he sent Mu'adh ibn Jabal to the people of Yemen, which indicates that the Prophet ﷺ, as in the management courses, they would say, he was empowering him. He was delegating to him powers that are not similar to any other person. Umar ibn Khattab used to say, whoever wants to learn fiqh must come to Mu'adh ibn Jabal. What an endorsement is this from the Prophet ﷺ, from Umar, from the companions. And if we go list them, it would take us a long, long time. Now, what is it that the Prophet taught Mu'adh to say? He taught him a simple statement, Allahumma. So you're calling Allah Azza wa Jal by his beautiful name and attributes. And this is the best way to call Allah Azza wa Jal. The more you praise Allah, the quicker the answer for your prayer is. Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. So you want a'inni. And a'inni is asking Allah Azza wa Jal for assistance. Asking Allah for support and for help. Because without Allah's help, you are helpless. I got an email from a questioner this morning saying that I'm a Muslim, but I can't believe that Allah controls everything. What an imbecile, subhanallah. He says, if I study good, I will get good grades. If I work hard, I will get a salary. So where does Allah come in all of this? Subhanallah. Can you prevent illness from coming to you if you're so strong and macho? No. If you get sick, can you get yourself cured? No. How many people do you know that work really hard for 14 or 16 hours a day and they're jobless? Or they're not being paid except pennies? How many people you know who work only 5 or 10 minutes a day and they get a very heavy and fat paycheck? How many you know who spend hours studying and get zeros? And some do not. See, Allah created everything and created the means to take you there. And He told you, you have to follow the means, but you have to depend on Me. So if you depend on Allah without taking the means, you will fail. Like someone wanting a child of his offspring. And he sits home, closes the door, says, oh Allah, grant me a healthy child. Ya akhi, will you conceive? You need to get married. And your wife has to conceive. It's not you. He said, no. I'm asking Allah Azza wa Jalla. I'm depending on Him. It will never happen. Because Allah made roads for you to walk in and through. So you need Allah in every step you make. Every breath you take. Everything you do. You need Allah Azza wa Jal to help you and support you. Without Allah's help, Azza wa Jal, you have nothing. And that is why one of the treasures of Jannah is, there is a lot of treasures there, Shaykh. Which one you want? Huh? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. It's a treasure, as the Prophet said, of the Jannah. What does it mean? There is no strength, might, or power except by Allah Azza wa Jalla. Nothing. No matter how strong you think you are. And that is why when Allah is with you, no one can defeat you. كم من فئة قليلة غلبت فئة كثيرة بإذن الله. How many among those very little who managed to overtake and beat the so many big and huge armies by the grace of Allah Azza wa Jal? And the Prophet used to always, alayhi salatu wasalam, command his companions to seek help and assistance of Allah. In the hadith of Ibn Abbas, you all know, إِذَا سَأَلْتَ فَاسْأَلِ اللَّهِ. If you ask, ask who? Ask Allah. And وَإِنْ اسْتَعَنْتَ فَاسْتَعِنْ بِاللَّهِ. And if you seek the help of someone, seek the help of Allah. So asking, which is dua, and seeking the help. Dua in a hadith is what?
The weapon of the Muslim.
Yes, but the hadith, الدعاء هو العبادة, meaning that invoking Allah Azza wa Jal, making dua, is actually and virtually the ibadah. And the second part of the equation, وَإِذَا اسْتَعَنْتَ, and if you seek the guidance and the assistance, seek that of Allah Azza wa Jal. So worship and seeking assistance. This is exactly what we recite every single time we pray. When we say, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We cannot worship any other than Allah Azza wa Jal. You alone we worship and you alone we seek for help. The Prophet so often used to make dua, رَبِّ أَعِنِّي وَلَا تُعِنْ عَلَيْهِ. Oh Allah, help me and do not help others against me. And also he used to open his speeches, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, by saying, إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ لِلَّهِ نَحْمَدُهُ وَنَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُهُ. that all praise due to Allah Azza wa Jal. We praise Him, we seek His help. Without Allah's help, you are nothing. And this is why. A'inni. On what? On dhikrik. On remembering you. If Allah Azza wa Jal helps you, if Allah Azza wa Jal loves you, in this case, you will find yourself among those whom Allah has chosen. Those who remember Him in the day and night. Those who recite the Quran in the day and the night. Those who wake up, they say their morning supplications. Those when going out, they say their exit and re-entry supplications, if you may. It, when they ride in their car, when they eat, when they enter the lavatories, when they sit in their homes, when they go to bed after their salat, all these adhkar, they are always observing them. Who gave you this ability? It's Allah Azza wa Jal, because Allah loves you. And this is why you will find these people always as if they are in a fortress. Shaitan comes, tries to attack, but they always have these defense lines. If he manages to penetrate one, he could not penetrate the second or the third or the fourth. So they're always protected, not against viruses. This is not antivirus program. This is the biggest protection program you can acquire, and it doesn't require money. It requires connecting your heart to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And that is why it is extremely difficult, if not impossible, for them to get an evil eye, to get possession of jinn, to be casted a spell of black magic, etc., to be envied. Why? Because it always comes and crush and be crushed on this big rock and on the walls of the fortress of dhikr. On the contrary, those who fail to read a portion of the Quran every single day, let it be as small as a juzu. Every Muslim should at least finish the Quran once a month. At least. I know people who finish the Quran twice a month from their memory. I know a friend who by memory revises the Quran two juzu a day, not looking, just reciting it, and night prayer. This is the least you could do. Those who are unable to do this, those who are unable to make dhikr, yani just recall, when driving here, did you say, Bismillah, tawakkaltu ala Allah, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah, subhanahu alladhi sakhkhara lana hadha wa ma kunna lahu muqrinin wa inna li rabbina muqalibun? A lot of people don't even bother. Or remember at the end of the night, oops, I didn't say that, and I didn't say this. And most of them complain all of the time that they don't have enough time to say the adhkar. They don't have someone to remind them. They don't have the willpower to maintain this every single day. And what I fear most are not these excuses. What I fear most is that Allah Azza wa Jal does not want you. Could it be? Could it be that Allah Azza wa Jal is neglecting you and does not want you? Allah mentioned in chapter 9, I love this ayah, and I'm terrified and intimidated by it at the same time. That's why I quote it. Not that I'm Zakir Naik, I know it by heart. No. It's chapter 9, verse 46. Allah Azza wa Jalla is addressing the hypocrites who refused and failed to go with the Prophet on the Battle of Tabuk on the 9th year of Hijrah. Allah says, and if they had intended to march out, certainly they would have made some preparation for it. If they were sincere, they would have got their bags packed and they went with the Prophet ﷺ. Allah says, but Allah was averse to their being sent forth, so He made them lag behind. Who made them lag behind? Allah Azza wa Jal. Who made you lag behind every single fajr you don't pray in the masjid? Do you think that, wallah, I overslept? For how long? Wallah, for the past 10 years, I've been oversleeping. Oh, mashallah, how many days did you miss going on time? No, not a single day. They will deduct my salary. I will get a warning letter. They will terminate my, mashallah. And what about terminating you from Jannah? Yes, Shaykh, Allah is ghafoorun raheem. Well, my bosses, you don't know my boss. Yaqi, you don't know my Lord. This is your problem. You think that Allah Azza wa Jal is going to forgive all of your sins with a carte blanche? He can. It's in His hand. It's up to His will. But you are playing a dangerous game when you think that definitely I'm going to win. Go to Las Vegas and play poker. And look what happens to your money. You're betting on the wrong chips. Don't ever take Allah Azza wa Jalla's mercy for granted. They'll always be wishful and hopeful. And never ever neglect Allah's wrath and punishment. They'll always seek refuge in Him from it. Whoever Allah Azza wa Jalla helps him, gives him assistance, you will always find his heart, his tongue, and his deeds expressing gratitude. أعني على ذكرك. We've finished this. We could have spoken for a couple of hours about the virtues of dhikr, but this is not the time. This is just, you know, the tip of the iceberg. You inshallah could do the math. وشكرك. How can Allah Azza wa Jal help us to thank Him? By guiding your heart, your tongue, and your actions to do. So the heart is filled with gratitude to Allah Azza wa Jal. Wallahi, whenever I walk the streets and I see one of those African ladies, poor ladies, who are looking into the garbage and trying to get the soda cans to sell. You know the big bag they collect in like 6 hours, how much they charge for? 10 riyals. A lot of the time I just pick 10 riyals and give it to them, because what is 10 riyals for us? We give our children 400 riyals to spend in half an hour in the fun fairs. Nothing. Alhamdulillah, most of us. Well, some of us. Anyhow, this is beside the point. So whenever I see this poor woman working in the hot sun, my heart is filled with gratitude to Allah that He did not make my mother one like that. And He made my mother sitting home comfortably in the comfort of her home. Alhamdulillah, she does not need to work. Her children provide for her. A ni'mah, a blessing from Allah. So when you see someone who is underprivileged, less than you, is your heart filled with gratitude to Allah, or is it filled with arrogance? Look at him. Look at the car he drives. Look at the clothes he's wearing. Oof, ya akhi, the guy smells. What is this? Subhanallah. This is what your heart is filled of. Whoever Allah Azza wa Jal guides and helps, he will be able to thank Allah with his tongue. So every time when he sits among people, akhi, wallahi, it is hot. Today was hot. You're sweating like a pig. We will this. He said, Subhanallah. You call this hot? Look at those who work 8 hours in construction. Today I walked for about 10 minutes from my home to the bank at 11:30. And I said, listen, I need vitamin D and I need the drill. I'm fat. I'm clumsy. I need the workout. And I was sweating, but I was grateful to Allah that these 10 minutes reminded me of Allah's blessing upon me. Akhi, those who dig the cement for 8 hours, what do you think they're doing? What do you think they're going to do in Ramadan? So gratitude that you express through your deeds as well. Because alhamd, praising Allah, is by the tongue and by the heart. While thanking Allah, a shukr, can be with the tongue, with the heart, and with your organs, with your body. Allah says, وَعْمَلُوا آلَ دَاوُودَ شُكْرًا وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. Work, you, O family of David, with thanks. So when you act in showing and in expressing your gratitude, you're a good servant of Allah Azza wa Jal. So those who obey Allah, they are expressing their gratitude to Allah by their actions, by their deeds, by their organs. But those who always complain, those who whine and say, I don't have enough provisions, I am sick, I don't have enough time, look at everybody's getting a raise, I'm the only one who has been in my post for 2 years, I always do the dirty work. Those who do not protect their eyesight and their hearing from listening to haram, from looking to haram, those who enjoy watching movies and listening to music and looking at pictures of the opposite gender, those who do not protect their tongues whenever they sit, they backbite. This scholar has this and that. This da'i has this and that. My neighbor is one-eyed. My cousin is a pirate and he has a hook hand. What is this? What are you doing? Backbiting. They're having fun. They're enjoying their time. Those who do not reach out to the poor and give them from what Allah has given them. Those who do not offer with their limbs that Allah has blessed them with night prayer. Those who do not fast voluntary fasting. They have not expressed their gratitude to Allah Azza wa Jal through their limbs and bodies. Finally, the third one is, and worship you in the best way. Support me, help me, guide me to worship you in the best way. Why did he add the phrase best way? Because worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal is something that everybody claims. If you go to the Hindus, do they worship Allah? He said, yes. If you go to the Buddhist, if you go to the Sikh, if you go to the Christians, the Jews, everyone claims that he's worshipping Allah and he's doing a good job. Yet, we know that Allah Azza wa Jal does not accept your worship unless it has two conditions to be fulfilled. One is sincerity. Who are you worshipping? Allah. Then, okay, sincere. And how are you worshipping Him? In accordance to the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Step by step. In this case, these two conditions make your ibadah, your worship accepted. Other than that, it is null and void. Allah says in the Quran, it is He who has created death and life, that He may test you, which of you is best indeed. So this life we're in, we're enjoying it, we're having a blast. Everything we want is here, but this is only a test. And when you're my age, you understand what testing is. Because we have lived so many years having fun and playing around. But now we're coming to an end. And now we look back and say, Wallahi, I think we took the wrong turn. It should have been better than this. It should have been more prosperous and more beneficial. And we regret. But we're still thinking positive of Allah Azza wa Jal and having our full trust in Him. This life is a test. Some fail, some don't. Some pass. May Allah Azza wa Jal make us all among those who pass. Now, look at the hadith of the 73 cults or 73 sects in Islam. All in hell except one. Among the 72, how many do you know? Plenty. Do they worship Allah? Allahu Akbar. Some of them even worship Allah more than we do on the surface. Yet they are in hell. For example, Khawarij. The Khawarij, the Prophet told us alayhi salam, that when you see them, you look down upon your own worship, upon your own ibadah, upon your own salat and fasting. Your own salat and your own fasting sounds nothing compared to them. Because they pray all night long, and they fast all day long, and they do so many things of ibadah, they read the Quran a lot. Yet, this did not stop the Prophet ﷺ from describing them to us as we see them. And he said, they are the worst of the dogs of hell. With all these prayers and fasting, yes, they are the worst of the dogs of hell. And they are the worst of people killed under the heavens. Whoever kills them has this and that. And if I were, the Prophet says, and if I were to see them, I would annihilate them. I would kill them. Like the killing of Ad and Thamud. Why is that? They're worshipping Allah. No, they were not. Their worship is not in accordance to the policy and procedure of the Prophet ﷺ, his sunnah, to the Quran. They follow and obey their whims and desires. And this is the decisive factor in all of us. We all have big beards, short thobes. When we see each other, Jazakallahu khayran. When we play football, MashaAllah, Tabarakallah, he scored the goal. Akhi, pass the ball. Jazakallahu khayran. These are mutawwi'as when they play football. It's very nice. And when they score goal, mashallah, all of them prostrate for thankfulness and gratitude of Allah Azza wa Jal. Tawwaz, when they play football, they're extremely fun. But is it in accordance with the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salam? I always give this example. I'm fascinated by it. Most of us claim to be practicing Muslims, committed Muslims. Islam is a frame. You buy where you put your pictures in. Your life is the picture. A proper Muslim brings Islam, puts it on the picture, which is his life, and cuts the extra edges. So anything in my life that does not fit Islam, it's down the drain it goes. This is a real Muslim who submits his will to Allah Azza wa Jal. Unfortunately, nowadays, we put the frame on our lives, but this frame is small. Can we have XX large? No, this is only size. It doesn't fit. So what to do? You break one edge. You bring duct tape. You break another edge and put duct tape. At the end result, you will find that your life is intact, but the frame you put is so crooked and uneven. This is not Islam that the Prophet brought, alayhi salatu wasalam. So each and every one of us must ask himself this question: am I worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal as He instructed, as He directed? Am I doing what the Prophet wants me to do? How would I know this? By knowledge. You cannot go to the sea and start fishing some knowledge. And if you do, you'll get sewer, because all the sewer goes into the beach here. You have to go like 12 miles out of the international waters to get fresh fish, unfortunately. Knowledge needs for you to read, to learn, to come to knowledge circles, to ask scholars, to be with them, to have a portion of the Quran that you always contemplate on, you revise and memorize and so on. So in order to reach what Allah wants you to be, you have to acquire knowledge. And then you would be able to attain the position of husn al-ibadah, of worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal as He directed. Finally, and I think, alhamdulillah, we managed to squeeze it in the allocated time, hopefully. When do I say this beautiful dua? Allahumma a'inni ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. The hadith says, do not leave this dua at the end of the prayer. Some scholars say you say it after salam. And others say you say it before salam. And the most authentic opinion is you say it before salam. Why? Because it was the Prophet himself, alayhi salam, when he taught us the tashahud, he told us, and then choose whatever of dua you want. Meaning that this position between after you finish the tashahud and before salam is one of the places where Allah accepts your dua. So there are two most favored places and locations in salah for you to make dua. Are you in stress? Do you have debts? Do you have problems in your work? Do you have a nagging wife? Who doesn't? Anyhow, does this reach your sisters? Do you have a nagging husband? I don't, alhamdulillah. So what to do? Ya akhi, supplicate to Allah. Where? Whenever you're making sujood. And after tashahud and before salam. So even in fard salat? Yes, even in fard salat. Anything worldly? Oh Allah, pay off my debts? Yes, go ahead, no problem. What about in my native language? If you can't make it in Arabic, it's permissible for you to make it in your own native language. So can you say, Allahumma ghafirli? He said, yeah, I can do that. So you cannot say, oh Allah, forgive me. Can you say, Allahumma qdi anni dayni wa aslih li zawji wa dhurriyati? He said, no, I can't. What does that mean? Oh Allah, pay off my debts and make my wife and children among the righteous people. So no, I don't know how to do this in Arabic, Sheikh. Do it in your language, no problem. In fard, in nafil. This is what I have to say to you. And I pray to Allah Azza wa Jal that it was beneficial, and that Allah Azza wa Jal makes our deeds sincere for His sake.